I'm Cathie Ugrin. Thread is my pencil, fabric is my paint. The artwork created is my voice. What I create is what I live. Every piece is unique. Each one has a name, and they all have a story. When I was younger, I was a complete non-soul, but always creative, artistic, sensitive, and introverted. Always drawing, I loved the tactileness of having a pencil in hand and playing piano. This was how I expressed myself. Art was a safe means of communication and dealing with things for me. I lived in a family with mental illness. My mom, dad, sister, and I each had our roles within this dynamic, which we just naturally fell into and maintained for as long as I can remember. Living with mental illness and sharing those experiences is why I created the exhibit, Feeling from Without and Within. My mom was probably mentally ill for her whole adult life to some degree. She was first generation of Mennonite upbringing, whose parents had fled Russia in the 1920s and raised in a very religious household. She had scarlet fever at 13 years old, where she was isolated from her family for 6 weeks and ended up with lasting effects to her nervous system. The sudden death of her father, just after she was married, the potpourri of meds she was on, the long-standing and mostly untreated anxiety, and family history of depression and dementia all contributed to her state of mind. She was the healthiest when she was working, but eventually got too old to work. My sister, Laura, and I were raised in a home filled with love, support, and generosity. But there was also inconsistency, fear, and confusion due to my mom's behavior. I dealt with it by escaping, and Laura dealt with it by always trying to be a better daughter. We were Mennonite, so there really wasn't any discussion. When we were older, Laura, who was studying away, and I always debriefed about the mom situation, as it still affected us and was a major issue in our lives. Our responses were more or less the same: angry, hurt, but mostly bewildered. My mom was getting worse until finally in 2006, she was diagnosed with schizoaffective disorder when she began hearing voices, was deeply depressed, and having suicidal thoughts. This diagnosis made a big impact on Laura, as she realized the illness had never been her fault. The effect on me was different, because I had never felt responsible. I was worried and so concerned for my mom and dad, but really had no resolution of my childhood angst. The general impact on our family was so huge that my dad, Laura, and I had to talk. We had to work together and support each other. The wondrous thing that happened was my family, and especially my dad, my sister, and I developed a beautiful, open relationship as a result. Mom continued to get worse through the next 12 years. She was at home with my dad as her primary caregiver for 8 of those years. We all experienced many varied emotions and reactions throughout this hard and somewhat terrifying period. Finally, she was admitted to the Batania Nursing Home. She was so strong through all of this and always tried to stay present, despite voices, delusions, hallucinations, and the pain she was experiencing. Even at the end, at 75 pounds, she never lost her power over me. I was always still that deeply hurt and confused little girl. Laura was the good daughter and extremely supportive for Dad and I, although we all maintained our original roles in some aspect until the end. The vigil at Mom's bedside just this past April, which is a surprisingly beautiful and heartwarming experience, gave some resolution to me, but I felt the final release of her death gave both my mom and I freedom, and I felt closer to her than I had for a very long time. Her funeral reminded us of the wonderful person she was in her healthier days and was extremely healing. We had been so consumed with the mental illness, we didn't remember or even think about the person she was prior to that period. The funeral was filled with art in the forms of writing, music, and fiber, and everyone present responded and commented on how uplifted they felt. The creation of my artwork is a journey through the time of discovering myself with art and dealing with the presence of mental illness in my life. I was a nurse for 20 years. I'm a mother and a grandmother. I've studied with various fiber artists and am actively involved in a vibrant fiber arts community. I have very little formal education in either art or mental health, but have lived with both for my whole life. So, I'm presenting myself here today as a case study. Let's talk about color for a few minutes. I've had a relationship with color for my whole life. I understand it, remember it, feel a particular way from it, need it, and it helps me to understand things. I've had very little formal training in color, but tend to forget the rules and regulations and generally just follow my gut. Let's talk about synesthesia. The definition of synesthesia is the production of a sense impression relating to one sense or part of the body by stimulation of another sense or part of the body. In other words, the crossing over of senses. I experience synesthesia, not all the time, but regularly. I hear in color, I taste in color, and I feel the energy of what is around me in color. I also think and imagine in color, which can affect my impressions and decisions. At first, the result of this blending of senses was alarming and a little disturbing, but I am so familiar with it now, I don't even consciously recognize it when it is happening anymore. Last November, Amy Bueller from the 12th Street Gallery in Brandon offered me the months of September and October 2018 to exhibit at her gallery. This was just about the same time that I was doing a lot of thinking about how experiences outside of yourself can affect the way you feel on the inside, and how sharing those feelings can then affect others. It seemed serendipitous and a great fit. So the fiber art show, Healing from Without and Within, began. Really, it all started with a poem. In 1997, I was feeling very unsatisfied and empty, desperately needing to figure things out. So I turned to color and writing to get in touch with my feelings and emotions. I decided on poetry, as it seemed a less restricted and more abstract genre. I turned inward and basically wrote what I felt. This was at the pre-quilting stage of my life. When I started preparing for this show, I knew I needed to have an identity piece and use the poem I had written years ago as the inspiration. Black and white and gray. You see in black and white, I see in gray. To you, the world is simple, with lines clean and straight. My world is like a maze, with some paths clear as day, but others leading astray. You know the way and feel content in the fact that you do. I feel my way through, and though I'm less self-assured, with the discovery of a path that is true, I experience the wonder of that which is new. You think in black and white, I think in gray. Concrete, analytical, long range describe the thoughts of your day, while abstract and symbolic reflect the working of my brain. You understand your thoughts and feel content in the fact that you do. I sometimes feel confused, lost, and bemused by all the different shades of gray that I use, for all the different ways that I choose to think. Yet when I do, I experience the vividness of that which is me. You speak in black and white, I speak in gray. You get your point across in a very direct way. I explain and describe. I tend to stray from what it was I was trying to say. You speak your mind and feel content in the fact that you do. I can create a mess when I try to. But when I can see the picture of my thoughts through the descriptions that I use, I experience the beauty of that which is me. You exist in black and white, I am in gray. Fulfillment is yours by the order of your day. Discovery is mine by the different tones of gray. You are being yourself and feel content in the fact that you do. Black and white symbolizes the clarity, which is you. The child in me is the clue that gray symbolizes the struggle in you. And as I continue to exist as I do, I experience the harmony of the old and new. The thing about black and white and gray is the way we feel comfortable in our own particular way. Black and white is structured. So there you like to stay. Gray has many depths and unclear rights of way, which make you feel confused and full of dismay. So there you don't often stray. But if somehow you could see that deep within the gray is the secret to humility and empathy that may clarify the soul in this world that's gone astray, and bring you peace and gentleness and loving every day. And oh, the saddest thing for me to have to say is, very often I feel black and white instead of shades gray. The traditional black and white squares were extremely difficult and time-consuming for me to do, and they are still far from perfect. I felt so restrained and critical of my own technique. The gray-purple section was absolutely liberating in comparison, even though it is still traditionally pieced compared to what I usually do. I really felt the difference in the two personality types through my sewing, and found I was so very glad to be gray. When my mom was diagnosed with schizoaffective disorder, it was like chaos for me emotionally. Everything was out of my control, unpredictable, and unknown. There was so much turmoil within me that I had to create something to channel the energy and overwhelming emotions. Again, I turned to color as a safe way to try to resolve or at least start understanding. Having control in the form of the repetitious 2-inch squares was very therapeutic, as was working with the many hues of colors that represented the way I was feeling. I started with the darks and worked my way through to the lights, which ended up being reflective of what was also happening in real life. I found this process of piecing very comforting and hopeful. It took almost a year to make, as I just had to walk away from it at times. Into the Light was created in my early quilting days. This is the artist statement I wrote for. Into the Light was created during a dark period when my mother, who had been mentally ill for years, was diagnosed with schizoaffective disorder. This official diagnosis was the catalyst for my family to come to terms with the painful reality we had avoided directly dealing with for some time. My mother owned a sewing machine shop for many years, and I wanted to make a piece that honored traditional technique while using a combination of modern cottons, batik, reclaimed material from Mama's stash, and very old found fabrics, all cut into 2-inch squares. The juxtaposition of these disparate fabrics represents the cascade of experiences and difficult emotions you were forced to embrace, and tells the story of how we discovered the existence of love and joy through our struggle. The dark blues and harsh browns represent the one step forward, 2 steps back progress made at the beginning of our journey. Through perseverance, determination, courage, and undying love, these colors transition to the turquoises and beiges of forgiveness, humor, and companionship, striving always towards the light of peace. The brightness would not be as vibrant without the darkness surrounding it. The journey would not be as extraordinary without the realization that we could always reach into the light. A bit more about the exhibit. At the beginning of last year, I needed to process the ways I was feeling at this late stage of Mom's illness and how it had affected me and my family. I also felt very strongly that I was feeling in this particular way. Others were as well, and could probably relate to the art. Some of the characteristics and ways people respond to certain events seems to be universal for families that live with mental illness. I could spot them from a mile away, looking after others, always wanting to make it better, feeling helpless, hypervigilant with solutions, restless, exhausted, feeling responsible, and taking on too much. Once again, I turned inside and thought about all the ways I was feeling. I had a glimmer of an idea for each of the emotional topics represented in this exhibit. I jotted it down and started from there. I really spent time. Each one has a topic, a definition of the topic, a title, and an art statement. I'll read the topic, the title, the artist statement, and say a few words about each. Fear and sadness. Fear and sadness are 2 sides of the same coin to me, so these 2 pieces had to be related. They had to hang beside each other, and they were given the 2 names within the title of the show. To me, fear is blue, and has its roots in childhood. Its origins are outside of the self. I don't really like the color blue as a general rule. Sadness is teal. I feel quite drawn to this as a color, and generally more comfortable with sadness than fear. With certain shades of teal, I actually feel a physical response. Aqua is related to teal, and to me, is the color that represents the energy and the joy of life. It is lightness, it is creativity, it is generosity and nurturing. It is never far away from me, even in my darkest days, so I had to include it in both of these pieces. In fear, it is almost indistinguishable, and in sadness, it is in the distance, but much more obvious and still reachable. So on the topic of fear, without, what is the color of fear? When I was spending time with and thinking about fear, all I saw in my mind's eye was overwhelming, huge, drippy blobs of blue. According to the experts, blue is the color of depression, which is as terrifyingly familiar to me as the illness I watched both my mom and grandmother struggle with for years. maybe it's not a coincidence that, for me, the color of depression and that of fear are identical. On sadness, within. Similar to fear, sadness is all-encompassing and completely overwhelming. But while fear starts outside of the body, sadness lives within. The color of sadness to me is a greenish blue, a very specific teal-like shade that makes my shoulders hunch and heart hurt just to think of. Yet, I feel drawn to this color for its true expression of melancholy. Surprisingly, teal's cousin, aqua, symbolizes the vibrancy, excitement, and pure joy of being alive. So this is the color I have used for the background behind the profile of my poor, sad soul. Isolation. This hand-dyed piece of peachy, fleshy-looking muted fabric was perfect, as it seemed to reflect the insipid and lifeless way you feel when you are isolated. Lots of different colors and types of tulle were used in creating isolation to represent fragility. Interestingly, I've actually used tulle in quite a few pieces in this exhibit. Also, the isolated figure is just one of many scattered figures throughout my fiber art pieces, which is completely new for me. I have never had people in any of my previous work. On isolation. Isolation. A community of like-spirited figures with arms open and welcoming dance, exist, and help one another through all the textures of life on this muted, hand-dyed piece of cloth by Val Wilson. One isolated figure sits hunched in a rectangular cell with nothing but shadow surrounding him all around. Although the purple lines of communication are freely offered, the only obtainable solutions here are pain, loneliness, alienation, and abandonment. Layers and layers of multicolored tulle are built up throughout the piece and juxtapositioned with a few random heart seams at the bottom to symbolize the complexity and fragility of life and its conditions. On madness, within the caverns of the mind. Tendrils of madness, wormholes, and danger are what live within the caverns of the mind. Places of terror and fear and strangeness of self. Enormous and menacing enough to become lost forever. But I believe there is still a tiny silent corner hidden where care is familiar and I can remember the existence of love. Within the caverns of the mind was created from the perspective of the person suffering from madness. Heidi Hunter's incredible hand-dyed cloth and several different types of black thread are what were primarily used to stitch an immense, terrifying space where just a tiny pool of safety and sanity remains, and the ghostly figures of a mother and her two beloved daughters continue to exist. Strength and faith. I knew these two pieces had to be white and almost invisible. White is a color that looks like nothing, and yet is made up of all the colors in the visible spectrum. Similarly, strength and faith seem straightforward and simple, but are both such complex virtues, so powerful, and so multidimensional. The pieces needed to be relatively small and within the realm of possibility for anyone, because they are experiences that confront everyone. On strength, by a thread. Just like in the barely visible is what symbolizes the quietness and courage of standing by your convictions and doing what you feel is right. The soul within the swirl of the web shines brightly through the many layers of life, reminding us to stay true and remain strong. To create the soul within the swirl of the web, I use thread that glows in the dark to give an added dimension to the piece and a big surprise when we walk by it at night. On faith, free fall or flight. Flight or free fall. Trust or stupidity. Acceptance or denial. Freedom or restraint. Conviction or disbelief. Sense or nonsense. Free fall or flight. Cool. Just imagine. My hero was my dad's mom, Oma B. She was a Mennonite woman who emigrated from Russia in the late 1920s and a self-proclaimed tough guy that lived to be 101 years old. Her life was wrought with difficulties and hardships, and yet she embraced creativity, love, determination, and hope. The phrase she repeated to her children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren over and over again was just imagine. This incredible ice-dyed piece of fabric by Susan Selby reminds me of the way I felt whenever Oma B said those words to me. Now, technically speaking, this fabric by Susan was created by piling a mound of ice atop a piece of prepared white fabric and then sprinkling some dye over. The cold temperature destabilizes the dye and causes the colors to fracture when they drip through the layers of ice or snow and onto the cloth. This not knowing what I'm doing really appeals to me as an artist and also speaks to the spirit of my grandmother, who saw and created art out of just about anything. Perseverance, love, and tranquility. This trifecta of emotions and states of being are vital to my existence and truly the wisdom I have gained through the years of my mom being sick. Perseverance was simply what my family did on a day-to-day basis. Sometimes it was easy, most times extremely difficult, but definitely an ongoing, continuous process. It has reminded me of what I can achieve or put up with, and has served me well as a woman and an artist. The art piece, on and on and on, is truly a study in perseverance. As my sewing machine broke at one point, my original design idea did not look as I had envisioned it at all. And finally, I had to add another whole layer of stitching to achieve the concept of on and on and on. Perseverance, on and on and on. The words of perseverance are listed and sewn into the very foundation of this piece, and every one of the conditions they describe are necessary and vital during the hard times when they are desperately needed. These words are steadfastness, tenacity, determination, patience, endurance, diligence, dedication, commitment, stamina, purpose, difficulties, discouragement, obstacles, intentionality, never give up, belief, growth, focus, will, hard work, faith, achievement, courage, strength, success, extraordinary. Goals. Opposition. Obstacles. Power. One day at a time. Problem solving. Continuance. Guts. Drive. Positivity. Resolution. Backbone. Longevity. Resoluteness. Nerve. Energy. Conviction. Reliance. Try. Tolerance. Restraint. Sufferance. Hard. Wisdom. Stupidity. Stubbornness. Sleepless nights. Worry. Cry. Fear. Delusion. Loneliness. Failure. Despair. Encouragement. Frustration. Honesty. On and on and on. Love was our foundation, and tranquility is what I aspire to and work towards. My tranquility piece was actually sparked by a quiet and much needed winter walk through the Assiniboine forest in the very early morning when the stars were still in the sky and I was acutely aware of all the different levels and layers of nature that surrounded me. On tranquility, listen softly. Tranquility lives within the quiet, still spaces of nature. Here, among the trees of a phantom winter wood, a wondrous and mysterious presence glimmers down from above, whilst the dormant layers of a vibrant living earth lay below asleep, under a dense snowy blanket. Inspiration flutters down like countless luminescent snowflakes as imagination stirs. There's room here to shift the tensions and turmoil of life and breathe full. A place to rediscover the innocence of peace. Freedom to pause and listen softly. So it came time to do my imagination piece, the one I was looking forward to the most. What would I do? The possibilities were endless. So much so, I was feeling a bit overwhelmed and blocked. I decided to trust my imagination just started. On imagination, the picture of my thoughts. The freedom and terror of putting an empty piece of white fabric under the needle and just starting to sew is the foundation of this picture of my thoughts. At times both easy and hard, at times surprising, the journey through the creation of this piece is a lesson and a message to all about who really is the artist within. My wonderful and supportive son, Ron, had some suggestions that I did against my better judgment and that I ended up spending a day picking out. I see and feel something different every time I look at this piece. It reminds me about the importance of staying true to yourself and trusting your instincts. On joy, turtles all the way down. Turtles all the way down is an exquisite orchestral piece composed by my daughter, Heidi Willett, that was commissioned and performed by the MCO this past May. As I was proudly sitting and listening to its premiere, I found myself transcended by a solitary transitional note within a bleak passage midway through. In that moment, I felt overwhelming joy, lightness of spirit, and the feeling that anything was possible. While creating my fiber art piece, Turtles All the Way Down, I tried over and over, unsuccessfully, to recreate this exhilaration with a single turtle exploding through the surface of the water. It was then that I realized that the beautiful note symbolized process, not the result, and my struggling, brave turtles attempting to swim upward from the bottom were indeed the very essence of joy. When I had decided that this moment of joy in the music was what I wanted to focus on, I asked my daughter Heidi to send me the score for the 20 seconds before and after the inspirational note. She informed me that this particular section in her composition was all about sharing, and that the particular 20 seconds I had requested were actually borrowed from a piece she had written for my mom when she was diagnosed with schizoaffective disorder. The fact that I was now borrowing it back for my joy piece just seems like a natural progression of the energy and flow of creativity and openness. My sister Laura and I have been close for our entire life, but when we were much younger, Laura wanted nothing more than to hang out with me all the time, and I wanted nothing more than to be by myself or with my friends. She and me is the cropped version of this photo taken of Laura and I at that time. Look at those facial expressions. Now, Laura is one of my best friends, and that is a big statement, as I have amazing, patient, and generous friends that I couldn't live without. On friendship, she and me. Here I stand, feeling out of place, not quite knowing where my home is, where the right place for my soul is, secluded and alone, but not. There, at the edge of awareness, I sense a presence, a friend, a family, a fellowship. I don't know how to embrace her into what I see and do. I don't know what I see and do without her. She will help me walk through the numbness that holds her distant and only part. I will take a firmer grasp on her hand to reaffirm that I am not alone and afraid, until slowly I realize I am not holding on to anything at all, that I am simply standing, whole and complete, and she is with me like she has always been, and that now I am again she and me. When I become overwhelmed, I pull into myself and my creativity. It's a safe place to hide, but not a healthy one for long periods of time, as perspective and reality become blurred. Friendship, the state of being friends by definition, is the undercurrent and life support that I am fortunate enough to have with me at all times, in both spirit and body, even during these isolated lost times. It is ever-present and unconditional, and I love and thank all those who are my friends. In the exhibit, I wanted to include some of my older work that had been created with an emotion or state of being in mind. It is interesting that this theme tends to run through my work for years already, and without always a purposeful intention to do so. On trepidation, storm, looking out of my studio window in the dead of the cold, harsh Manitoba winter, I see pristine snow, dense forest, buildings, reflections, clear blue icy sky, and swirling wind. Feeling that something is coming lingers in the air all around, ominously. Storm is that moment in time, capturing the barren beauty and forbidding sense of trepidation felt as the tempest of a winter blizzard descends and surrounds us. On respect, echoes. With a nod of thanks to history and tradition, I have created a fiber art piece out of one of the most basic and loved of quilt squares, the log cabin. Using an array of varied fabrics in the vibrant colors that I love and thousands of tiny stitches, Echoes is a statement of appreciating the past whilst embracing the present. On resistance, threads of resistance. A pretty little scrap of pink fabric can be overlooked and dismissed. Many sewn together create a sensual and powerful flow of intoxicating color and energy. Similarly, an individual voice is faint and can be ignored. Many raised together as one create an inescapable flow of determination and strength. Threads of Resistance is a fabric art piece created in reaction to the Women's March of 2017. It is a statement of the immediate, powerful, and necessary reaction of women and men in response to the presence of oppression, divisiveness, and destruction. Technical note, Threads of Resistance is actually a two-sided piece where the front represents strength, freedom, and the power of raising our voices. The back symbolizes how apathy and persecution can enslave and make us powerless. The quilting holding both sides together is the women's symbol. On the front, you see the quilting stitch as part of the flow of power. But on the back, it looks like the women are restricted and trapped behind the bars. On gratitude, above the forest floor. Sometimes, one of the most challenging things for us to do is remember to be grateful during times of hardship. Challenging, but also tremendously rewarding. Sorting through and focusing on the positive moments and events and simplifying the complexities of life allows us to have an emotional and energetic shift. Above the Forest Floor was created as a reminder to find those beautiful, unique, individual leaves amongst the fallen mists. Identify and embrace those beautiful moments within a difficult day. On existence, migratory pathways. Just like migrating birds, we return. The natural cycle of life pulls us back to self, to home, and to whom we have come from. It is birth and death and life in between. It is love and being. It is a universal condition of humanity. No matter what happens, the instinct waits and beckons us. Draws us back to the starting point to then go forth and again return. The creation of this exhibit was nothing less than illuminating for me. I discovered characteristics and strengths about myself as an artist and a person. I revisited hidden and forgotten memories. I explored uncharted territory. I reaffirmed my voice. I was able to remember my life through the creative safety net of art. Sean McNiff, art therapist, in his book, Art as Medicine, says, I view the making of art as a medicine that proceeds through different phases of creation and reflection. Although therapists and other people involved in this process make their contributions as guides and witnesses, the medicinal agent is the art itself. Creating these fiber art pieces has given me a greater perspective on both the past and the present. My friend, Rose Nickel, sums up the role of the artist perfectly. She says, this belief became mine while I was studying for my master's in theology at seminary. It was there new God thoughts were being explored and tested, and I saw how eventually, through these theologians' writings and teachings, the church's beliefs eventually changed over time. Society is beyond today's norm and pushing at all the edges of current thought and practice. As they present their world views to the rest of us, eventually their discoveries and processes become the new norm among the masses. They are the conscience of the people and the ones who eventually change how we all think about it.